You may have heard of murder hornets, and before they were ever given that infamous name, I had been in Vietnam for several years studying hornets and bees as they interact in nature. My name is Heather Matala, and I'm an associate professor at Wellesley College, where I study honeybees and honeybee behavior. The murder hornets that you hear about in the news are a species of hornet that we call Vespa mandarinia. The study species that we worked on in Vietnam is Vespa soar. They are two very closely related species of giant hornet, and their behavior is very similar. These hornets can flip into a certain mode of hunting where many hornets will show up together from the same family, from the same home, and they'll start attacking the colony together. And their goal in this kind of attack is to wipe out the adult's defenders and take over the honeybee colony. My co-author, Guard Otis, would be in Vietnam and he'd be in beekeeper yards. He would see this stuff spotted around the entrance of the colonies, and he would say to beekeepers, "What is this?" And they would say, "Oh, I don't know. I've never noticed it myself," or, "I've seen it, but I don't know what it is." And there was a single beekeeper who said, "They do that when they're attacked by the giant hornet, and I'm pretty sure it's animal dung because I've seen them collecting it in my water buffalo field." And Guard was telling me about it and saying, you know, that this would be crazy if bees were doing this, because honeybees don't forage for dung. They forage for things from plants. And for them to be standing on top of dung, picking it up and carrying it home would be a really huge shift. So this first video is something that we took really early on in our time in Vietnam, where we were just trying to establish that it really was bees putting spots on the fronts of hives. So we cleaned off hives and then videotaped them all day long and looked for changes in spots on the front. Here's a close-up of an unmarked bee using her mouth parts to kind of, what we would say, apply that spot to the front of the hive. So what we have here is an example of a worker honeybee foraging on a dung pile, and they seem to be intent on finding something in particular, and they would pull and pull and pull and then finally take off. One thing we tried to do was mark bees as they were foraging on the surface of the dung, and that was so that we could see where they were going back home once they brought this stuff home. And you know, over and over again, what we saw was some pretty focused behavior by the bees. So these are a couple of examples of what the hornets were doing when they would approach a colony that had what we called moderate to heavy levels of spotting. So you'll see these hornets approaching the colony, but under these circumstances with some heavy spotting, they kind of dance around the entrance. We don't know why they're bothered by it. At this point, we don't know what the bees are searching for in the dung that they're foraging on. More likely than not though, there's probably something in the feces that the bees are searching for that is specifically a compound that's specifically repellent to the hornet. What that is remains a mystery. The other category of explanation falls under camouflage. So they could be trying to mask the smell of colonies themselves, or they could be trying to mask the smells that the hornets put on the hives when they're starting their group attacks on the hive. So the hornets mark the colonies with pheromones that help other hornets find those colonies, and it could be that the dung helps to mask those smells. Here we have several examples of what happens to colonies when they have virtually no spots or really light spotting, like under 100 spots. And they're just chewing on the front of the entrance. They're trying to figure out how to get inside. And you can see from the edge of the entrance that they've already gnawed off a lot of it. If you're interested in learning more about our work with hornets and honeybees, you can look it up on FLOSS One, which is an open access journal and free for anyone who has access to the internet to find it and read this study, or you can read about it in your friendly local newspaper. It's going to be covered in lots of places like the New York Times, The Guardian, Wired Magazine, and many, many more, including by our funder, National Geographic.